Rocky, is the decision final?
Yes.
Rocky, Rocky, over here, please. Is this the first time the champion has given up his crown?
I don't know about that.
Doesn't the title mean anything to you anymore?
Not until this is over.
Considering Rocky's known punching power, do you still think this is going to be an easy fight?
Yes, of course.
It's a method of science. And evolution. Isn't it, gentlemen? Drago is the most perfectly trained athlete ever. This other man has not the size, the endurance, or the genetics to win. It's physically impossible for this little man to win. Drago is a look at the future.
Champ, there's been no mention of it yet, but how much are you making for this fight?
No money. It's not about money.
Has the fight date been set yet?
December 25th.
Why Christmas?
That's what I was told.
Where?
It's in Russia.
Do you expect me to talk?
Welcome to episode 71 of Do You Expect Us to Talk? I'm your host Becca, and joining me are my fellow world champions Chris and Dave. How are you?
What are we world champions of? Oh, don't answer that in my
chat! Case. That's what it is, Dave! Chat!
Yes. It's been a chatalogue of success. I'm just seeing knowing me, knowing you in my head.
Uh-huh.
We'll have a chatathon.
Well, we did have our own chat line for once, didn't we?
Sorry? I thought our own chat line. Honestly, 50, I thought, did 50, I miss 50. Something there? Oh, right. No, we've got our own chat line jingle. We haven't got our own chat line.
Well, see, I was busy
we're,
mostly.
We're not suggesting to listeners they can call up and hear me, like, you know, finish quickly.
With a cheap call.
I don't know how you should say that, Dave.
I should say finish quickly, to be fair.
Well, at least you'd be quick. Wouldn't cost you much. Save your money.
For that as a service. I don't know
this
who gets
a bit weird now.
Who benefits out of that? I've never quite understood the whole point of like chat lines anyway, to be honest.
Not one of those like porn as well.
Anyway, are we ready to set your hearts on fire?
Oh, God. What, with a burning heart?
Oh,
there's no easy way out of these puns.
Fixing a pigeon.
Oh dear. Yes, that time has come. We must break as we discuss Rocky IV.
I got a message from Becca earlier today, or we got a message from Becca. And she just said, "Where's that line in the film?" Because she'd never seen it before. She was just desperate to hear it.
And I also misquoted it as well.
I think she wanted to make sure she quoted it correctly and it vaguely sounded like it sounded in her head.
But just, I remember that I had an old boyfriend and he was a big fan of the Rocky movies at the time and I'd still not seen them then. And he was always going to be, "I was broke," and just always quoting Ivan Drago. And I was like, what? I didn't have a clue. But he both had a bomb movie, so it was all right. But anyway, moving on.
All right. I'm just thinking, what a loyal and devoted girlfriend you were. You're interested in Rocky? I'm not fucking watching any of that.
She was in the next room watching Roger Moore films.
Watching Roger Moore. We had other interests, so it was all right.
She was on the chat line.
He was probably on the chat line, actually.
While watching greasy, sweaty men fighting each other. Yeah, I'd be concerned about that relationship.
I love how Dolph sweats his way through this film.
Well, I mean, he's playing sport for quite a lot of it, to be fair.
Like you said the other week, you do want to get a squeegee and just be like...
What, and make bum noises? Squeaky bum noises?
What is that kind of squeaky noise you make with a squeegee?
They're all, like, at the start of the match, he's already, like, sort of, like, got glades of sweat all over each other. They're, like, not even starting...
done anything.
Yeah, they're just standing there, like, glaring at each other, and they're already, like, sort of, like, covered in beads of sweat. I'm like, Jesus Christ, how warm is it in there?
Well, you are supposed to warm up before you fight.
True, that could be it.
Rocky never looked that sweaty.
He did in this one. He did.
Yeah, and this one is getting we'll get there.
Because I honestly think this is the vainest one of the series, but it's the era we're in. Who's in this, Becca?
Well, as if you didn't know. Sylvester Stallone, Dolph Lundgren, Brigitte Nielsen, Carl Weathers, and Tony Burton, with music by Not That Other Guy, Vince DiCola, written and directed by Sly, and released in 1986.
Bit of a lack of respect for Vince DiCola there. You do know he did the animated Transformers film score.
Yes.
Wow, what a pedigree.
That
soundtrack is amazing.
I'm sorry.
That soundtrack is amazing, to be fair.
To be honest, I've never seen it. I wasn't into Transformers as a kid, so I've never seen the animated
Transformers.
Well, that's it. We're doing the Transformers series.
I'll do the Transformers series.
I'll
shout out
to my friend Mark,
who's
a massive Transformers fan.
Fine.
So I don't know.
I suspect you two don't really want to do it.
I don't care.
But was last though.
Yes, it was.
The ignominy of it. Well, not the ignominy.
Yeah, but that doesn't speak to the film. That speaks to the fact he'd do any old toss for money.
I'm sure it's considered a cult classic somewhere along the lines.
Yeah.
I'll speak to my friend Mark about that one because he's the biggest, well, he's the biggest Transformers fan that I know.
And you still
consider
him a friend?
So I shall seek his expertise on that.
Christ.
Aww.
Anyway, so we can do our really embarrassing Drago impressions.
I'm be embarrassing. I won't bust it out. It'd just be too accurate. You'd think he was here.
So, what are our opinions of Rocky IV going in then? What do we make of it in terms of like its kind of its place in pop culture, and also what kind of do we have sort of facts and figures on what it made at the time? Dave, kick us off.
Yeah. Okay. Well, facts and figures. Let's start with the budget. It was made for $28 million. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, the last one was 17, which was about 3 years before. Bigger budgets, bigger sort of salaries, I would have thought by now. But certainly, compared to the running time, that's quite expensive, I suppose.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
I cannot remember the cost of A View to a Kill, but I know Octopussy was about $28 million. It's kind of roughly in line with what Bond films of this era were costing. In terms of take, it is the most lucrative of the series. Took a shade over $300 million, very similar to Superman the movie, albeit a few years on from that. Last week took $270 million, the first one took $225 million. So factoring in inflation, it's not wildly over the top of the third film. But yeah, this is the most successful at the box office of any Rocky film. And it's the most expensive to date. In terms of what I think, this was long my least favourite. I think I was literally looking at it objectively from a quality perspective as much as I could. And I do think, I honestly think objectively 5 is a better film. But 5 isn't fun. It's very badly acted as well. I see why they set out to make 5 in the tone they did. But the end result, you just think, why is this even here? This film, I think, is probably the weakest in the series. It's non-stop montages. It's, you know, the dialogue's awful. The plot makes no fucking sense whatsoever. I think it's a really ill-advised advert for America in this era, a country I've got nothing against at all and whose people I've got nothing against at all. But if your only exposure to that country was this film, you'd think, what a bunch of wankers. It's fun, but I say that sort of almost in parentheses for the simple reason that we all watched it tonight and we sort of started the film within a few minutes of each other. So it wasn't close enough for us to almost live message each other on it, but we were commenting on it as we went along. And I was noticeably the most negative. I was noticeably the most negative.
And I think loved it. And Dave was like, yeah, it's bollocks.
Well, no, I said, yeah, but it's still bollocks. That doesn't say I didn't enjoy it, but it's a crap film.
Actually, we had a message on our Facebook, but I think it might have been whoever shared our status. We had a message from Jack Glugo, didn't we, just saying how basically he basically views it as perhaps the greatest Rocky film, but also the greatest film in existence. And
Rocky
everyone's
four.
Kind of coming around to it now.
Are they?
Which I think is
what,
fantastic.
There's this big wave towards Rocky IV? Was it on the ballot with Brexit? By the way, which is your favourite Rocky film?
I think what sends it over the edge is the fact that he had that sort of montage to No Easy Way Out, where you get to relive Rocky 1, 2 and 3. and you get to really...
There's no logic to the way that's cut together at all.
I think there is. I mean, it's not in like a narrative sense. It's more like... I swear, say narrative sense, as in was it within the flashback? They're not like told like in sync with each other, but
no, they're not.
But what I thought it was trying to do. No, I could be completely wrong, and it could be complete bollocks. Which, you know, I'd take that as well. But I think it's one lines of like Rocky thinking his thing. So at the beginning of it, he's driving along, he's thinking of Drago, seeing like punching, he's thinking of Apollo, and he sort of goes into shift to like what his wife's really thinking. And it's very much more.
Is that why he's in a car with 17 gears then?
Yes. But in terms of like flashback in between everything else,
it was like Suicide Squad, Chris. You know how Suicide Squad got to a certain point and then just showed us half the fucking film again? I mean, we start with flashbacks to things that are 2 minutes ago. Yeah. The running time's absolutely over the place. It's really short. Now, I've always looked at the montages and thought they didn't have the material, did they? But, you know, so they're just padding out the running time. But I heard, now, the distinction, we've talked about this before, there has to be a distinction between first cut and assembly cut. Now, you do hear of like the first assembling of a film being like 4 hours or something, but that's never intended to be a final cut of the film. That's just, let's put together all the scenes we shot and see what happens. Mm. And you may trim those scenes, you may have scenes where you've got the same information imparted in two or three different ways. Think of Star Wars with the Greedo scene and the Jabba scene that follows it, that's in the special edition. If it wasn't for George Lucas being a bit of a bellend by that point, one of those shouldn't be there, because they give the exact same information. That said, you still get to a point where you got the first cut where you're like, actually, I'd like you to consider this as a possible final cut. And the first cut of this was an hour longer. So there was enough material at one stage, unless the montages were like the 12-inch versions of the songs.
I did wonder, because it seems to be like it had all its plot like in the first 40 minutes. And then it was like montage training.
Bit of chess,
match,
another montage, yeah.
And then that's it.
So I think just to finish off the stocks, we'll go into the making of it and everything in just a little while. I really do almost sit on the fence with this film, which I know isn't good enough for a show of this nature. So I'll sort of come off the fence towards the end. But I at once think it's fun, and I also think it's dreadful. And I don't know where. But it's not an ironic dreadful like Superman 4. Where it's just horrendous and I sit laughing at it. It is fun. I didn't have a bad time with it tonight. But scene to scene, it really is dreadful. And to think this is the same series as a Best Picture winner, I don't know. I really don't know what they were thinking. And when you start reading about the sacrifices that went into the making of this as well, and what they physically put themselves through, you think, really? But there you go. We'll get into it scene to scene. It's a bit of a mess, but it's an iconic, fun mess.
I think what you're trying to get there, I think as an objective, as a piece of art, yes, it's terrible. But as a piece of entertainment, it's great. I think that's kind of where you're at of it, really. It's like, you know,
I think it's probably one of the best worst films I've ever seen.
If it's going to be this bad, let's not make it 2.5 hours. You know?
Yeah.
If you're going to give me a 91-minute Rocky film, this will do.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does plod along really at a really nice pace.
But in quality, Chris, it's been, my last word, I promise, before you get to your bit. The drop has been almost linear, though. The difference between 1 and 2, the difference between 2 and 3, and the difference between 3 and 4 are almost equal. And I'm not really talking entertainment there, but it's just quality.
I think you follow like the sequels like as you go with film. So obviously like Rocky 2 is a sequel to Rocky. Rocky 3 is a sequel to Rocky 2, and then Rocky 4 is a sequel to Rocky 3, you know, so when you look at it like that, it does make sense in that way, but when you compare Rocky 4 to Rocky, you go like, how the fuck do we get here? But there you go, it does owe a lot to the history of the franchise as well, you know, that we do get to relive a lot of the key moments that made the series what it is. So you do get a bit of a nostalgia trip. I think Carl Weathers is great yet again. I think he I think doing the series, I've kind of like a lot of respect for him as an actor, because he's very charismatic. You're thinking, Carl Weathers, yeah. I'd like, you think, why wouldn't you like a bigger star? I don't know, I don't get it.
Yeah,
but
I wondered the same, actually. No, he's I think he's one of the most sort of, along with Rocky, sort of the most iconic figures in like sports cinema. And one of the standout figures, obviously, in the Rocky series. And I was like, why isn't he a bigger name? Why had I not heard of him before?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, it's a bit of a shame, but I guess, you know, not everyone could be like, you know.
I guess his moment would. I guess the moment would have been
Action Jackson.
Like Action Jackson.
Yeah, which
that would have been if had that. I mean, it was popular enough, I think, but had that really blown
that
up?
That would have propelled him to stardom.
Maybe.
Well, I'm sure he obviously was a star, but even greater stardom.
For anyone who's not seen that film, I urge you to check it out, because that is equally bad and awesome at the same time. It's one of those films that came at like at the wrong time, just that like it was a cheesy action film where the tone, everyone was just ready for like more of a grittier, cooler vibe, you know, like it was like sort of trying to do like a glam rock album where just before Nirvana was about to break out. It's kinda like that, I describe Action Jackson. But yeah. So Rocky IV is I know what you mean, Dave, and in most respects, I actually agree with you. You know, it isn't a very good film. It's very weak. It's not. It doesn't have much on its bones. It's very just sort of that'll do plot. It's the script isn't very well fleshed out. There's not much on it at all. But it's directed in a kind of like a flashbang wallop kind of sensibility, which is really pacey, really fun. So it makes you kind of don't care, and it's just kind of like, yeah, it's more of a popcorn film than it is like a hard drama. But, you know, it is what it is. It's got Dolph Lundgren being like a machine almost. You got like characters making daft decisions that aren't really thought out, but okay, you just go along with him. And then because it's kind of one of the things where like you expect the characters to get to point A, so why does it really matter that much? You think, okay, well,
yeah,
you have to get Rocky.
I think
to fight,
that gets
so
to the nub of what I'm saying, Chris, that we are going to go scene to scene. A part of going from scene to scene in anything, even if it's a comedy, is picking apart the logic of it. It's part of what we're doing. So none of us are going to invalidate that anyone listening's feelings that this film's fun. I'll come closest because I like it less than certainly than Chris. I'll be interested to see what Becca says in a minute. But I really think that from scene to scene, I'm going to tread this film beyond how I feel about it, because I don't really dislike this film.
I mean, there are some like moments where I think are kind of thought out, like actually quite reasonably well thought out or kind of interesting. I might be overlooking it, but then there are some moments where I think, fucking hell, that's just stupid. As in like the robot, which we'll get to. Becca, what is your opinion?
Oh dear, that robot will be the abiding memory of my film.
There's a story with that, but we'll get to it.
There is, yeah. There's an interesting story with that, I think.
We'll get to it.
Yeah, so Rocky IV. excuse me. Yeah, this is probably one of the best films that I've seen, or best worst films that I've seen in a long time.
It's not a worst best film.
The best worst film.
out of all the best films I've ever seen, this was the worst.
That makes it sound like Crash, a crap best picture winner.
No, sorry, I got my words mixed up there, apologies. But no, I think of all the, like, for example, Superman 4, Die Another Day, all the other dud movies you've seen, all the series that we've explored so far. There's still quite a lot of heart in it, but it's just a complete child of the 80s. I mean, you've got the glitz and the glam of sort of the Las Vegas fight. We've got some poor characterisation. Sorry, slow, but like a script that you say, Chris, is not very well fleshed out. It's very paper thin characters, and there's just probably the most heady mix of sweat and baby oil that I've seen on screen since the Fast and Furious movies.
Certainly until The Rock came along.
Yeah, certainly. He sweated his way through the FNF series.
Yeah.
But no, it's just full of machismo and full of energy.
Rocky's a bit more like how he used to be though in this film than the last film.
He's very kind of dialed back, isn't he? Very dialed back.
Yeah, he's kind of gone back to little being like, oh, I'm a little bit of a simpleton, a little bit somewhat.
Yeah,
not quite as much.
There's a bit where he's like, Well, so you'll get to it. So it was miss his like nails versus nails, or vice versa.
Yeah.
But again, I think you've got that contrast between Drago, who sorry if I mispronounce his name, I'm really sorry. I'll try to say Drago. Yeah. Sorry.
Just say the Russian.
I will break you. Drago, sort of, for example, when he's kind of raised up just before he fights in Las Vegas, he's obviously not used to all kind of glitz and glamour and everything, sort of. Everything that is Vegas kind of like surrounding him, and you've got that very much compared to sort of to Rocky, who's very much from the streets, compared to somebody like Creed, who has all this kind of money and knows how
like John Peters and Kevin Smith.
Yeah, it's like that. Yeah, precisely.
From the streets, like Superman.
Oh, they're from Pitt. Well, you know what I mean. You know, from a rough neighborhood and actually fighting from
the streets of Smallville. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, from the street. He's just a, you know, street pug, but again, you've got that. Contrast again, with someone that, you know, a seasoned pro who's been there, done that, to somebody who's coming from, you know, the Eastern Bloc, and it's like a very, apart from all this technology, kind of very stripped back way of doing things. So I think that's a nice aspect that we haven't seen in the Rocky films for a long time. But
Cannon must have been gutted when they took Dolph Lundgren, stuck him in Masters of the Universe, and were like, oh shit, he was doing his best in Rocky.
Oh, I like Dolph.
Oh, poor Dolph. Oh dear. I loved Superman back in the day, and that kind of ruined it for me, unfortunately.
Oh, yeah, I have a lot of respect for Dolph, but...
He's got like a doctorate in mechanical engineering, wasn't
he? Yeah, he's actually...
Extremely smart man.
He's an absolute legend.
He's got 3 degrees, isn't he, or something stupid, and he speaks like...
He's had all of the 3 degrees.
But he speaks all these different languages as well. Like, he's just a polymath.
And apparently, a really nice guy.
But he lacked a certain screen presence. I once reviewed Masters of the Universe on another show, just as Chris did on another show as well, a different one. And I said that Dolph Lundgren made me a lot more grateful for Arnold Schwarzenegger. And what I mean by that is the knock on Arnold Schwarzenegger was he couldn't act and all the rest of it. And actually, but he's got a ton of screen presence, and you've only got to put someone like Dolph Lundgren on screen to prove that. An absolute vacuum by comparison.
I think that's a bit harsh. I think Dolph Lundgren is memorable. I think, yes, he isn't like...
He didn't even stand out in Masters of the Universe, and that was his film.
He was He-Man.
No, but then again, that film, they had other issues. I think they had like issues with like I think at the time, particularly when they were filming, because he was struggling with his English at the time, or like he was kind of told, well, it's all right, we'll just film it and then we'll just overdub it. But by the time they finished shooting, they ran out of money to overdub, so that he left with like the vocals that he did at the time when he wasn't really giving much performance, because he was thinking, well, it's all right, we'll just overdub it, I'll just, you know, and then I'll correct it there. So, you know, to be fair on Dolph on that, you know, he might have done a better job had it gone the way he was told it was going to go. I think with this he's got limited dialogue, which also helps. But I think you do get a sense of like who he is as a guy. I mean, it's not very, as again, the character work isn't particularly good, but given the fact that all he has to do is just stand there and glare and look like,
he's certainly very intimidating, isn't he? Even though, as you say, he doesn't say much, but just still in terms of his physicality, in terms of his demeanour, you just think, oh, shit,
It's not just that. I think you look in a kind of like, at times, you know, when he's in America, and we'll talk about the stuff what I think Dave's referring to, when he says, like, doesn't put America in a very good light. He looks like bewildered. He looks a bit scared. He looks a little bit like, oh my god, they're about to get me. And then he goes to anger. There are certain things we think actually, you know, you could say yes, he's doing what's been asked of him, but and it is quite simple, like instructions. But he does it really well.
It's the fault of the series. Where else do you go? You started with Rocky's opponent being an all-time great. Charismatic, fast, powerful, everything you could possibly want in an opponent. And the only way from there is more cartoonish. And of course, you've gone from that to Mr. T, who didn't keep his fucking mouth shut for 2 seconds. That's the character. I'm not knocking.
Yeah.
So where do you go from that? Where you go to someone who's quite taciturn by comparison.
Well, he's basically superhuman.
Yeah, and it's just, it's the fault of the film. When I knock Dolph Lundgren, I don't, I only mean, I didn't ever see him as a leading man. Whenever he did try to get a leading man sort of role, and I do think of something like Masters of the Universe, he's just a vacuum in the centre of the film. I'm certainly not saying that, like, he shouldn't have ever been offered work or anything.
Oh, yeah,
I'm not saying that at all. And there's one scene in particular in this film where I think he's pretty decent. I don't want to over-egg it, because there's only a couple of looks that he gives.
Well, that's all he's given to do anyway, so...
But that's all. But in terms of... It momentarily puts me on his side, because I'm like, actually, he's being served up as an oddity here.
Yeah.
That ring might as well come up and contain the Elephant Man that stood in the middle of it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't like it. I don't like that scene at all.
I know what I mean. There's, I would say he's kind of like just someone who's just being used. He's a puppet. So not just from like his trainers as well as like being like showed up as like this kind of, shall we say, freak show, or like this kind of like exhibition, which he kind of like was caught off guard. He's a little bit more like childlike in the sense that he just doesn't understand what's happening at the time, and he's just a little bit like... Like someone, like a foreigner in a country that is in somewhere that he just doesn't understand, you know.
Yeah, I get the impression you had a blast with it, Becca. Then.
Yeah, I did. It's a bit rough and ready in parts, but no, I really enjoyed it. Unfortunately, I've only seen this one the once, but no, I had a really fab time. It was really enjoyable to watch.
I think the irony of that is you've watched all the longer ones twice.
Yeah, and this little tiny one, I've only seen it the once.
And it's because you didn't have the time, because this was a last minute one.
No, but I will see this again for sure. So,
okay. Just my last thing on it. You talk about Die Another Day and Superman 4 as the comparable kind of films we've seen. They're not exactly the same because the budgets and stuff vary. But could they be bad?
Enjoyable.
I'd rather watch this over those two. For everything.
Yeah, I probably would as well.
Yeah.
It's kind of on a par, like, for me, though. It's kind of on a par with Dino the Day, just a little bit in terms of it's bad. But, well, not bad, but...
but it's expensive bad. They meant to do it.
No, that's it. But yeah, that had budget problems. You can't... I feel bad for sort of kicking it when it's down. But you can still enjoy it. Like, for example, obviously, you know, I had a great time watching it. Chris had fun watching it. And so, you know, I'm sure you did it as well. I'm sure you did too, Dave.
I watched it.
You watched it. You may have enjoyed it a little bit.
Tolerated it.
He tolerated it. That was it. He acknowledged its presence, but you can still have fun whilst you watch.
I just know where we're going, and whilst yes, it's of a very different tone, and I'll have a good laugh at some of it as we go through, and I don't hate it. I really don't. But the series not only starts so strong, but if Balboa and Creed are the last two, and that is it. It finished really, really strong too.
Mm.
So to have this in the middle, 91 minutes, and it's largely montage, and, you know, part of me is pleased this film exists. Part of me thinks it was mental that this film exists.
I love the fact it exists.
Next week, yeah, I mean, I'll watch it again as we prepare for next week. From memory, 5 is a better film with significant drawbacks in that they cast a guy in it who really, really can't act. But I would never miss it if I never saw it again. Whereas I think there'll be times in my life where I'm like, I'm going to stick Rocky IV on.
Why not?
Yeah, it's one of those ones where you got like a few beers down, you have a few friends around, you know. It's one of those films.
You'll be in that mood, haven't you?
Yeah,
alcohol and distractions are vital.
You sit there on the couch, singing onto like, there's no easy way out, like, and like...
It's one, you know, cheesy film on with your mates and whack it on.
Yeah, it's good fun. You can't really go wrong with it, really.
Right, so shall we start by doing this film sequentially and doing the last 3 minutes of our last podcast?
Previously on Rocky 3. How many times do we see it over and over again?
And then if you want to send in a picture of a blowjob and carrier pigeons and stuff.
And don't forget the double-taking pigeon.
So, yeah, so don't we start with, like, the big, massive silver... like boxing gloves, one of an American, one like the Russian flag on.
Yeah.
So the first Rocky movie that didn't start
this
with Rocky in great big letters.
Yeah. It starts with Eye the Tiger.
Yeah, we get the kind of American gloves and the Russian gloves that kind of smash.
Oh God, this is so fucking on the nose, isn't it? And then we cut to him fighting Mr. T again. Of course, everything was shot on celluloid back then. And what I always notice with all of these films is when you watch, particularly watching them close together, when you watch the end of the previous one, but it's the start of the next one, it's way grainier than it was on the version you watched it originally. Because it's like the film maybe hasn't been stored that well, or it's being reused. So, yeah, Rocky III actually looks pretty shit at the start of this film. But we see him beat Clubber again.
Yeah, we just basically sort of relive the same old thing, and then we get like the ending where, him and Creed have that favour, quotation marks.
Ding, ding.
Yeah.
We see all of that again.
Yeah.
It's like, previously
on Rocky III.
Better edited. You know, all this shit about, you've taught me everything I know, well, almost. You fight great, I'm a great fighter. Ding, ding.
The end.
Oh, no, sorry, that's blowjob noises. I haven't actually ever given a blowjob, so I'm guessing at what it was.
They might as well run on the beach together and have,
Yeah.
But, yeah, so I think we're 4 or 5 minutes into the film again before it starts. And it's Rocky arriving home after this fight, which after mashing the shit out of each other in two fights, he's put a light bruise on his right cheek.
Yeah, I'm quite surprised, actually. He managed to get away so lightly.
I mean, like, maybe I was, like, wrong, but I remember, and maybe I'm just, incorrect here, but I always thought that fight came pretty much the night when he beat Clubber.
I never read it that way, because they would have let, he got cut by Clubber. I think they would have let him heal.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, but I think it was how it was kind of, like, put together. It just felt like it just happened, like, That same night,
I mean, if I was Apollo, that's what I'd demand. I don't care if you're tired and cut.
Ding, ding.
Yeah, ding, ding indeed.
Something similar next week.
So,
this is just... the thing is, we've always seen the end of the previous film, but because it finished on this slightly comedic note anyway, it really does feel superfluous now. It's like, couldn't we have gone straight from the end of the fight? Did we need this winding up to hit each other bit? I don't know.
I thought it might be at this point tradition. Like, let's just show the last moments of Rocket of the last Rocket.
Yeah, they just literally grab that 4 minutes. It's like, all right, it's maybe. Like,
or maybe like, shit, it's not even 90 minutes. We need to add a little bit more. Yeah.
He gets home and... Caesar's an annoying little shit in this one, isn't he?
Well, a lot of your time in your face.
I feel sorry for Paulie, really. Because Paulie's sat there smoking a cigar, like, it's his birthday. He's waiting for Rocky to get home so he can, like, eat his birthday cake. He's like, fuck's sake, Rocky, what are you doing? Sorry, I was just finding Apollo.
I wish that had been both the dialogue and the delivery. What the fuck are you doing, Rocky? Oh, you're finding Apollo.
That's literally what he said.
Oh, brilliant.
But he does get his cake delivered to him by a pretty awesome 80s robot.
If you say so.
Yeah,
happy birthday, Paulie.
Yeah.
What's this for?
The backstory is, baby, I feel bad now, but I'm going to stick to my guns. Baby Caesar from film 2 was, and I don't know how to pronounce the name, but I'm going to go with more or less how it's written. Sergio Stallone? Sage Stallone's younger brother grew up, they diagnosed him quite young as autistic. And this robot helped him with that. I've not read much on how, but he wrote him into the film as like a little thing for his son.
Oh, okay.
Which actually makes it quite sweet and also makes my Caesar jabs really nasty. but at the same time, I didn't know that backstory. The average film goer wouldn't know that backstory, which makes it a mental fucking idea in a film which has got so much like American excess in it.
Well, it's just how it's kind of pulled off, because it's like, what's this robot do? It's kind of like a robot butler, but how useful that is, I don't know. Because I imagine you still.
It's a telephone as well. We find out.
Okay.
It's a kind of it's a vision of the future, isn't it? Pretty much as well. It's like how we imagine, like for example, you see these videos of sort of 50s and 60s of how robots will help us in the future. I mean, at the moment, you do have like animatronic figures that in Japan helping older people with dementia and Alzheimer's and things like that. And we have things of like, I don't know, like Roomba, I guess. I'm trying to think of
the next time we see it, it's got a breathy female voice.
And there's another Paulie.
Paulie is asking, is mentioning having her tube wires tied. The implication being, Paulie's fucking this thing.
Well, he just got, you know, well, she's in love with me, you know.
Well, what's really fucked up is, like, you have Caesar there, and he actually, like, Rocky actually refers to it as his robot. And it's like, hang on, you just literally just gave this as, like, as Paulie's birthday present. He doesn't seem that pleased at the time. Gets, like, whipped cream sprayed at him just as he's about to blow out the candle. So he's like, oh, right, great. Well, what a great birthday. And then you just give the fucking robot to your son.
Doesn't it all feel like filler, though?
Yeah, oh, yes.
I mean, when you think Rocky III showed us their lifestyle in a very short montage, and I'm not arguing this film should have... Christ, this film should not have more montages.
I counted, but like, five or six montages.
Counting some of the training, some of the fights as well. I mean, yeah, you could even count in things that aren't montages in that they're filler, but we'll get to them. I mean, James Brown thing, you could count that in the number because it's 5 or 6 minutes that the film's going nowhere.
No, it's just James Brown. It's an advert. That section is an advert for James Brown, isn't it? And living in America and...
I think it was the
fault. Get down with your bird song.
He went to prison for beating up a woman. Lovely man, James Brown. Loved it, like a lot of his music.
Still the godfather of soul.
Horrible human being. But, yeah, so this is all bollocks. I mean, we got the kid who won't shut up. And he's saying, you're developing a very loud personality. And it's like, yes, he really is. I really hope he's sidelined quite quick in this. And thankfully, he kind of is.
It makes you grateful that you just leave him at home every opportunity, don't it?
Yeah. It's an attempt at humour as well, because the whole, like, squirty cream thing isn't that funny or interesting.
Yeah.
Tells you it's a very different audience than that would go to a pure action film, I suppose. I can't imagine them putting that in a Chuck Norris film of the era.
I don't know. Have you seen some Chuck Norris films?
Yeah, to be fair, I haven't seen a lot of them. But where do we go from there? Is it straight to Apollo at the pool?
I think so. Because basically we get the first glimpse of...
It's a sign of how thin this film is.
Well, yeah.
The second full scene and we're going, they can't be there already.
Like, it was an anniversary between of Rocky and Adrian, isn't it? And then I think from there we do go to the pool.
We see his awesome PJs, don't we?
Well,
he does have some amazing PJs.
Looks a bit like his robe from Rocky Balboa.
Like, yeah, black with the gold piping.
It kind of looked like sailor's outfit.
It does a little bit. That's very smart.
But again, it goes on for ages. This woman who's really not happy, he still fights. Here's a cake of a boxing ring, right? And then he bangs on about how it's been 9 years and it still feels new.
Convincing, doesn't she?
Then he hands her a fucking horrible watch. That looks really
It's very 80s.
It's very new money.
It's pretty, but it's quite dated.
It looks like a snake though.
It's what
It won't bite it, so it's all right.
It's what somebody of that era who won the lottery would buy.
As you know, I said, very 80s, very 80s.
So that's all padding. And then we cut to Apollo in the pool playing with his dogs.
Yeah, then catch the ball but with his... Yeah. Puppy. Yes, 3, 2, 3 is all the pups in the pool.
Yeah, watching TV by the pool, which is probably not really safe, but okay.
I just thought that, not very health and safety.
Yeah. Well, he's not making toast at the same time, are
he? No. He's on borrowed...
Really shocking encounters.
He's on borrowed time anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
I must say, I didn't... Obviously, haven't seen this film before. I didn't know it was coming.
Did you not?
And that really surprised me. I was like,
You've seen Creed?
No, I know, but obviously, you know, prior to having seen Creed, I had not seen this film before. I haven't seen Creed, I knew it was coming.
You just knew it was something Rocky was at, and you don't know what's in mind. So. All right, fair enough.
Yeah, no, obviously I haven't seen Creed. I don't know. So.
It kind of upset me. It upsets me less now I know he was cheating on his wife at this point.
But yeah, so basically he's seen like this new Russian boxer, Drago. I'm not sure what is the deal. He's basically like, he's picked up, like, as this new,
like... He's something like, and I'll probably get his rank wrong, but he's something like a captain in the Russian army. And he's a world amateur champion. And they come to America to announce he's going to fight professionally. And they seek a match with an exhibition with Rocky. He sees that and basically calls Rocky and says, I'm on my way round. And they sit and watch old fight videos and chat. And he announces that he wants to fight him.
Yeah. So what's the reason? So basically he originally wants to fight Rocky, but Apollo goes, no, actually I want to fight him.
Yeah, he says, well, you know, he said, you'll beat him after I got through with him. And it's like, well, that'll devalue it slightly, won't it, if you beat him? But it's painted as Apollo misses the fame, the applause.
Yes.
It's all gone too quiet. Now, it's a shifting timeline. So it isn't 9 years since the first fight, even though they've been married 9 years and that happened after the first fight. But we believe he retired after Rocky beat him. And we're told that's 5 years before. Well, strictly, if this was right after the last film, Rocky's won his title somewhere between 3 and 4 years before. And of course, the kid's now about 8 because the marriage is now about 9. So it all gets a bit confused. But in this timeline, he retired 5 years before. So he's past it. The guy is past it. If you look at the time for the original film, he'd have been about 34, I believe. So this guy's coming up on 40, hasn't had a fight in 5 years. And he wants to fight him, but it's an exhibition, so he probably assumes there's not a great deal of risk. But Adrian tries to talk him out of it.
Yeah, he looks at it as kind of like, well, he's obviously wet behind the ears, he's not as experienced as me, so I can just go in and...
He also says that, and this is the bit where I just feel that this film's gone a bit mental in the whole Cold War bit, that he's going, it's us versus them. And yeah. It's like, that reminds me of when I watched American Sniper and he was totally into it's us versus them, and yet I'm totally convinced if you'd asked the character what it was all about, he wouldn't have a fucking clue. And I feel a bit like that here, that you didn't need to spout that bit. The missing the fame and adulation
was enough.
And trying to beat the hot young thing is fair enough.
Yeah, I guess it was possibly the attitude at the time as well.
Yeah.
I guess that kind of element as well.
But again, we're already having summits by this point. It's a bit like Superman 4 in that it's a little bit... Actually, I suppose when they were filming this through 85, Gorbachev came in 85, so maybe yeah. It was a bit early to tell at that stage.
I think also, to get the point, what the film actually does say at the end, as cheesy as it is, I suppose it's like an attempt to have had a little bit of that in there. A little bit of that sort of, like, you know, us and them hostility on the American side as well.
The way we've been looking at it might be wrong. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you know, I mean, like, you know, maybe I'm putting too much depth
well, yeah,
into this.
As you can't have 45 minutes of America and then
yeah.
Crap wrong. I don't know. Anyway, credits.
Yeah. So,
that's pretty much it.
So, yeah. See, right, but basically Adrian is like, I mean, I do remember, like, Adrian always being the one who's like, oh god, you know, being the moany wife at home, and I guess
she's got a point here. You haven't fought in 5 years.
The ultimate purpose of Adrian, and particularly in this film, actually, and maybe possibly in like the others as well, she's kind of like the voice of the audience, in the sense that she asks the questions that need to be asked. It's like, why do you want to fight him? Why shouldn't you be retired? Aren't you too old? Like, what's the point?
Yes, but when it comes to Rocky, she is the diametric opposite of what the audience wants.
Yes. I mean, obviously...
But somebody has to ask those questions. Yes.
So she
is... It's almost a form of exposition, asking why he's doing it. Okay.
So she tries to talk common sense, but obviously he's like... No, he has a conversation with Rocky about like how he has to do it because he just feels like he's a fighter. Blah blah blah. I think
that pissed me off in Rocky Balboa, which I like generally, but this whole fighters fight thing, and I think, well, no, you get too old. At some point.
Yeah, But well, yeah, but obviously, you know, Apollo's like a proud man, so he says, "Yeah, I'll fight this new Russian guy."
Yeah,
and yeah,
I'm glad he did it before Predator, because fighting one-handed would have been a fucking nightmare.
And yeah, so. And then we get to the press conference.
Oh, the press conference.
Yeah, which...
The press conference
angry
pisses
press conference
me off as well.
Just escalates
it's
quickly.
Ridiculous, because as soon as she says something like, you know, you think you're so good and we're so bad, they're leaping up in furious, all the journalists. And I'm thinking, journalists don't get that fucking emotionally involved, surely.
It's all planned, isn't it? Because at the end, he's like, oh, how did I go? Did I do all right?
It's planned by Apollo, but they don't know that.
No, they don't know that, exactly. They just escalate.
The other thing I read is... his manager, who I've blanked on the name of the actor, it's Michael something, I think, but he was also a Klingon in the original Star Trek series. Oh.
Our series are all linked. They're all part of the same universe.
Oh, shit. Yeah. he was supposed to have all the lines, including those that went to Bridget Nielsen's character. Bridget Nielsen was a very late addition. And when you think Sylvester Stallone was having an affair with her and later married her, that possibly explains why. Around that time, she had an affair with Arnold Schwarzenegger as well.
Wow.
Yeah. I've been reading all this today. She had a one-night stand at Cannes with Sean Penn as well. Reading all this. What was the other thing? Who's the other one? She's been married 5 times.
Flavor Flav as well. She
Flavor Flav, she dated. Gosh. But there's another famous guy. I'm trying to think who it was. It's not someone you would expect either, but it doesn't matter anyway. But so she was written in as a late addition. They've gone a bit severe on her. I mean, she had short hair anyway, but they put her in a lot of sort of power dressing. And the bit that I find ludicrous with her.
Tony Scott. On. She had an affair with Tony Scott.
Tony Scott.
Oh, really?
That was the one. Well done. I don't know why I'm saying
that's
well done.
You don't
I've just looked it up.
Yes.
It's not like you got hold of Ridley Scott and said, do you know anything about this?
Just quickly missed it.
Yeah, like, well done for looking at Wikipedia.
Like, just on enough chance. Yeah. Do you know if do you know anything about who Bridget Nielsen slept with? What, brother Tony? Oh, okay.
I was lucky. I nearly called Christopher Nolan for no apparent reason. I get the whole have Drago buttoned up, you know, indicative of a society where maybe free speech isn't necessarily that valued. The manager is a bit too full on with the it'll be a great victory, you don't have the science or genetics. But they put it out fairly dispassionately. They're not meaning to insult anyone. That's the impression I get.
Yeah.
And the journalist.
Yeah, that's the kind of impression that she gives for sure. I mean, she's kind of
Apollo's trying to be
putting sort of a good front on saying, you know, we are, because she says, she doesn't basically come out like compared to Creed, for example, who was like, you know, I'm going to win. But, Mrs. Drago is basically, you know,
American style and all that, and it's
just like, you know, we're going to win, but I don't want to sound too confident.
Particularly with the scene that comes next, that's not good.
Yeah, I mean, like, a Creed is doing what Creed does. He's basically sort of being like
shtick. I know it's shtick,
because that's just what he's doing. The press are like basically just picking up on it, and you kind of feel sorry for Drago, and because you're right, when they first come in, they are very much like, you know, coming up almost respectfully, but the trainer all of a sudden comes like a belligerent arsehole. So, but he's in fairness, so it's like, I feel sorry for Drago, because I feel like he's just been used as like kind of like this puppet that's just been like caught in this like shit show of a boxing match, and I just think, oh, he's kind of getting abused from both. He's getting shit from like from his manager. He's getting, you know, he's getting used from his manager. He's getting shit for it because of it, and I just feel, oh, bless, you know. And it's it's not going to end well, because obviously he's big.
I just think you know, Creed is a stereotype big mouthed American here. That's how he would be looked at. And bear in mind, the first few scenes of the film are all about Rocky's cars, Rocky's fucking robots. You know, it's wealth porn, you know. But I just think, if you're trying to set out our lifestyle against theirs, or our ideology against theirs, you've stepped right in the wrong direction here.
I mean, as I said before, it's like, it's like what the film ultimately says at the end. I suppose it's trying to like bring people together more than anything. So I guess
I'm a bellend and you're a bellend.
Yeah. I mean, like, you know, I suppose, you know, maybe it wasn't Stallone's intention at the time. So you could be right, Dave, but I think if he was here to spend it, he'd probably come up with the excuse that, well, you know, that's the whole point, to have like both sides misbehave and they come together.
I mean, I can tell you almost there's two very stereotyped, if you like, things that happen on the Russian side much later in the film where you go, oh yeah, they're meant to be the bad guys. But until that point, he's a disciplined athlete who just thinks he can maybe make a living out of it. And he just gets thrown into the middle of all this quite offensive razzmatazz.
You can tell he's visually shocked by it all, isn't he? He's like, well, what is this? You know.
Well, as I said, it's just like that bit where he just looks kind of like confused and a bit like
I would have been
concerned, and then gets aggressive because he feels like, hang on, what, this guy's like pushing me now? And now, you know, so...
I'd have been happier if at the press conference you could have had him doing everything he did, because you've got Rocky there going, oh, he needs a stepladder, and trying to make light of it.
Mm.
If the journalists weren't leaping up and looking rabid as well, I think if it had just been a bit of grandstanding from Apollo, it wouldn't have been so bad. But the roaring of the journalist prompts his wife into saying things, and suddenly it's like, what's the point of this scene? It doesn't go too well. And then, of course, we cut straight to the event, which does appear to be Las Vegas.
Yes. And again, I mean, yeah, we have like the Rocky and Apollo sort of talking him through. You know, he's all pumped. He's all training. He's basically sort of...
I feel bored again. Bit on the nose.
Yeah, I was like, yeah. And then poor Drago, he's kind of like, again, used like as this prop almost. Like, he's just like lifted. He goes in a ring, which is like desolate and empty, and he just gets lifted up. And he just gets like sort of like...
used. Could they have been any more offensive if they'd rolled up like barrels full of money and set it on fire in front of him? You know, they bring him up out of the ground, clearly bewildered.
That would have been the ultimate insult,
really. And then it is 5 minutes of how amazing America is.
Yeah. Like, you know, in only way, like Apollo Creed does, which is like,
it's just have so James over Brown. The top, though. You think, well, way to play down fucking tensions, you know?
Yeah. But I guess, like, the reason why they do build this anger in Drago, and it's like, it's a mistake. So, in the day,
and I don't see how James Brown singing about fixing a pigeon is
patriotic. We are going to have to find that music video where
misinterpreted
their lines.
Hey!
At the start of a club singer.
Hey! Yeah.
I saw him live a couple of years before he died.
And he was fixing a pigeon.
He wasn't fixing a pigeon. Oh, this is just fraught with dangers of mystery.
He puts on quite a show, I must imagine.
Oh, you know, the man I'm not so fond of, but, you know, James Brown's was always entertaining.
Simmons, what?
You know, and Apollo really making a show of it. I can understand that it's an exhibition, so he will make a show of it. And, you know, in some respects, some of the imagery I don't have a problem with. Even him dressing as Uncle Sam wouldn't necessarily be that big a deal. You know, it's just, you know, it's just like, well, I am American. We're fighting the Russian tonight.
You expect it off him anyway, don't you? I mean, if he is like as famous, you know, world heavyweight,
but it goes on forever, like... because I did some time checks, I'll have forgotten some of them, but we cut to like Vegas at about 20 minutes in, or certainly I think maybe Apollo's dressing room at 20 minutes in. They don't square off at each other until something like 29 and a half minutes. And he's dead before 34 minutes. So we've had 9 minutes of bullshit, 4 minutes of fighting, and dead. This film has just got it all arse end up.
But yeah, I think you could say that if it wasn't for Apollo being like grandizing the situation and going too over the top, too antagonistic, he wouldn't he probably just would have lost the fight and not got killed. You know,
I think this is clumsy, though, isn't it? Because you get all of that crap, and then they go to fight, and it's like, you will lose.
Yeah.
Which is just, what an actor. And a bit like Rocky 3 with Rocky, he looks good for about 30 seconds. And then and then the corner tell Drago to do something because they literally become dominant. I mean, you might as well have the trainers in this saying, be dominant for a bit. And that would be their advice because that's literally what they do when they speak. If this was fucking real, Drago would be on a fucking manslaughter charge. Or, well, America would be. It would be some degree of murder here.
Yeah.
What, by hitting him off the bell as well and things like that?
He's hitting him after the bell. He's hitting him while he's on the floor. It's all of it. He actually pushes the referee out of the way to keep going after the bell. This is effectively murder to some degree.
Technically, the killer blow happened in the ring, fair and square. It was only like, all that shit kind of happened within the first round. So
that is true.
So I mean, I'm not making excuses, but that's how it was. I mean, I was expecting it to be like that as well. Because
the look he gives his wife just as he goes out into the second round, no mention of the mistress, is actually, it got me a bit tonight. Just the way he's looking at it. I think he knows it's futile, and it got to me tonight. I'm not quite sure why.
What I thought was actually quite subtle in not quite a subtle film. Like there was a moment.
America, he hinted.
Yes, no.
He hinted subtly.
It's when Rocky's talking to him after the first round, saying like, "Look, we've got to forfeit the match because you're getting killed out there," and he tells him no, because of his pride. Don't you dare, like, sort of stop this fight. And so, you need to understand from Rocky's point of view, it's like, well, it's a bit hypocritical of me to say that because I said the same thing when I was fighting you. So there's a little bit of like an inner turmoil about that. So he goes, okay, and then so he goes in and then he's just getting his ass handed to him, and then he picks up the towel. As if that's ready to throw
shitload
it.
Shitload of continuity errors in that, but we'll skip over that. But yes, he does. He stands there with it.
Throw
the damn towel!
Yeah, but he hesitates. He's not sure whether he should do right by him or, what is the right. He's hesitant, and then he gets the killer blow, and he just drops the towel, and it just sort of like falls down. He doesn't throw it.
The only problem I've ever had with that is they rang the bell at the end of the last round and he carried on fucking beating him up for a while, having pushed the referee out of the way.
Yeah.
In the middle of his bloodlust, if this white towel lands beside him, is he just going to go, all right?
I know, but I think it makes it at least for the officials, I think it's just excuse for that inner guilt as well. It's like, shit, if I should have just thrown the towel. Or like I could have saved him. Or
yeah, we get reprises of that in Creed later on. It lives with him for a long time.
So I think for as much as this film has faults, I think that's
brilliant so far.
I think that is a nice little touch. You know, I think it's handled quite well. I think it actually works narratively for the character as well. I will give it that. So I thought it's a nice little touch. And plus, I do like the image of like the blood stained towel just like falling to the floor, like as a symbol, you know.
Yeah, the twitch. I've always liked some of the physicality of Carl Weathers, and of course, as he falls to the floor,
he's twitching,
which is consistent with major brain trauma, or can be. I think the whole build up to it's a bit ridiculous. I think they've gone way too cartoonish in the fight, but the sense of tragedy engulfing what was a fun little event, I think, has actually played pretty well.
Yeah. I think also because it's just like, you like Carl Weathers, you like Apollo, really. So to see him die is just like, oh, man, I didn't really want to see that. Really, it's kind of, it's a bit gutting, really. And also, it's another loss for Rocky. It's like, he's lost Mickey, he's kind of found, like, someone who's essentially replaced him.
He doesn't know it yet, but he's gained Adonis.
Oh. Yeah, that'll come in a few years.
Like, his wife that look, and I just think somewhere there's a mistress watching that on TV going, oh, fuck.
Well, we don't know, because she could have been like sort of sat right behind her. Could have been like an heir, rather than...
It's true.
Yeah, so Apollo's literally dying in his arms, and Drago says something that's kind of insensitive, which is like seeing you just killed him.
Yeah, he dies, he's like, oh, I mean,
it could be he's just broken English, he doesn't like, you know, can't translate well, but yeah, it's a bit fucking insensitive.
He's probably asked for a Diet Coke, he just doesn't know the fuck.
I didn't have any sort of repercussions for basically punching him to death, so I'm like, oh.
He's probably like, in Russia, that is just a minor injury. He'll be fine.
He's, you know, it's too small for him, and he's actually meant to say, if he diets, he diets, and he can fight in light heavyweight.
His whole thing was a big misunderstanding.
Misunderstanding.
But yeah, so we're at the funeral.
Doesn't Sly fall in love with his shitty dialogue in this series as it goes along?
I feel really bad for this scene because it's very sad, it's very poignant, but there are a few clunky lines that kind of kill the mood a little bit. But I think, yeah, you're right, definitely kind of starts kind of, obviously last week we lost Mickey, this week we're losing Apollo. But yeah, I just kind of think this scene, it's very touching, it's very sad, but also there's some bit clunky dialogue here, which is a bit, it kind of deflates the scene a little bit for me.
What made me smile thinking back on this is I saw this in the cinema. And I was very young. I think we got it just after Christmas here. It came out in November 85 in America. I'm pretty sure we got it in January. I haven't looked that up to verify it, but when you actually look at the last couple of...
I checked it on the IMDb.com.
I haven't checked it, but I got a feeling out, because I always thought the film was 86, and that's probably because we did get it after Christmas. I was 9 at the time. And I when I look back on it now...
Hang on, I've got it. January 24, 1986.
Right, okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, my mother took me to see it. And when I look back on it, I'm thinking, my mum was in her 30s at the time and she'd never seen a film before. Because I remember being stunned when we cut to the funeral. And it's like, she was stunned he died.
But, okay.
And it's like, but he was just twitching in the ring and this is clearly being built up as revenge. I think I might have been surprised at the time, by the way. I'm not saying I knew better, but it was like, looking back on it now, it's like a woman in her 30s was stunned that major brain trauma and twitching on the ground and Drago looking at Rocky and this narrative starting of revenge leads to a funeral. The problem, the film's going along all right at the moment. The speech is too long. I don't like the way he takes the... a belt out of a fucking like kit bag or something, but it's not got enough montages yet.
No, we are suffering from a distinct lack of montages, don't we? We've only had what, 2 or something so far.
It's almost like they signed up more. To do 6 and they've got halfway through and went, oh shit.
Well, we've got all this plot to get out of the way with, so we need to get all the plot out of the way.
Things to show with the passage of time.
Stop. We have now finished the plot more or less. There's one more plot scene, really.
Well, yeah, there's a couple. Yeah, they announced the fight, like almost like immediately. It's just like almost like a press conference. Like Rocky's just, yeah, I'm gonna fight in Russia, and
where's no money in Russia, naked, blindfolded, hands tied behind my back, barbed wire around my chest, Adrian, my wife plating 9 foreign sailors. in the dark. The level of difficulty on this is... There's a couple of things I don't like about this. But they announced this fight. And what makes me smile about it is several things. It's in Russia. No money. Christmas Day. And it's like... Again, they're trying too hard to paint them as soulless. Because why would you fight on Christmas Day in Russia and all the rest of it? No money. And it is ludicrous. And the other thing is, he's got Paulie sat beside him, who doesn't know this. So when he goes, it's in Russia, he's like, are you freaking crazy? And it's like, did you not discuss this on the way?
Well, apparently he doesn't, because he goes to see Adrian in a bit, and she's like, where have you, like...
And Adrian didn't know about it either.
She denies all knowledge.
They've set up a press conference. He's not told his wife. He's taken his brother-in-law and not told him the details at all until they get there. It's madness. Yeah. Really is.
That was a bit weird. Now, I can see why they would have it in Russia, obviously, because he's, you know, he's been receiving death threats. But it's just like, have you not told any of your team this? How do they not know?
Even no money I can go with, although he's turned professional now, so I don't see why not. But maybe it would be tasteless, I don't know. But leave the money issue out of the film entirely. I don't think you need to address that.
No.
Because they're not good capitalists. They don't even pay, you know. It's just, oh, fuck off. It's not necessary. The fact that it's Russia, yeah, that would add a level of difficulty, because particularly our society at the time, we'd have probably been distrustful. We'd have been like, what are they going to try to do to him and all
that's
the rest
of it. That's the whole ethos behind it, really.
It is, but Christmas Day? For fuck's sake. It's just like...
Do you think it was probably down to the fact that it was that time of year, the release date was, so they thought, oh, I just said it at Christmas?
I just think it was just to add another level of difficulty, another level of evil, if you like, that, God, they don't even respect Christmas. You know, it's fucking stupid.
I mean, to be honest, I didn't read it like that.
Honestly. I've always read all of this scene like this. It's just like, it could have gone on for another 5 minutes naming really stupid things. You know, and the ring will be on fire, and I won't be able to wear shoes, you know, and I'll you know, have to wear a crown of thorns, and it's over the top, it really is, and the fact that he hasn't even told his wife.
Yeah, that's the bit that's like, oh fuck's sake.
This
come
persists.
On.
I mean, we got a taste of it last week that they seem to forget they've got a son. This week's almost as bad, and next week we get a relationship with his son, where he is so cluelessly thoughtless. And it's just like, I know Rocky's not bright, but a reasonably bright man is writing this, and it's not good. We accept that Adrian's going to whine about it. She's got pretty good reason in this case in some respects. Particularly as, not only does he comes back to the house, she's got no idea, she's been accosted by a ton of journalists in her own home as well. And when he gets home and she's going, well, like, it doesn't have to be like this. He's saying, you know, he's got to be willing to kill me and I'm willing to die and all this shit. And it's like, you selfish prick. You've not told her this is happening. And now it's like, I don't care if he kills me. It's like, that is the message that comes across. You know, and it's just like, it's so ill thought through. And to think this is a guy who wrote an Oscar nominated screenplay, this is really poor. But it's redeemed with a fucking great montage.
I guess Rocky's just feeling the guilt. He's feeling the grief, so he has to wear that burden.
I get why he wants to fight him. I get the acknowledgement of the risk, but...
How it's handled.
Complete disregard for his wife's feelings.
Yeah.
You get the impression that him and Apollo have stayed friends for some time now.
Yeah, he kept in touch.
Again, shifting timeline, is this meant to be right after Rocky 3 and they've only just become friends? We don't know. But whatever the case, they're friends now. So Apollo comes around to the house and he can just ring up and say, I'm on my way. So they don't live that far apart and he is a comfortable visitor to the house, which would mean he's probably Adrian's friend too.
Yeah.
So he's Adrian's lost him as well. I'm overthinking a really shit film, but it's just like, I just wish this was a bit
smarter.
Well,
you know, you just see, I was just saying, you just seen someone kill your friend and now you want to go fight him. And you're just thinking, I don't think I like the sound of this. But obviously, what Sloan really needs to do is get in a car and drive to a montage.
Drive to a montage.
Yes.
And it tells us, it is true, because his predicament, there is no easy way out.
There's no shortcut home. There's no shortcut.
Mind's blown, eh?
Yeah.
Mind equals blown.
He drives off. He changes gear a lot in this. Very few American cars, generally, you know, I think they've got about the same sort of proportion stick shift as we've got automatics here.
And I think so,
That's very, very few. Comparatively, as a percentage, it's probably about 10%. Well, that's fair enough. He's got a stick shift, even though he couldn't drive the second film at all. You give him the easier difficulty level.
There's obviously a missing montage where he learned how to drive.
Do you really want a montage of that? Parallel parking and...
Yeah. You get about six of them in this film. Why can't we have another one?
To be fair, we don't see too much of the car outside. We only see sort of Rocky's like...
Yeah, he could be running over cows and everything, couldn't he?
Like, you know, it's like, no wonder he's changing the gears all the time. Because he's like cut outside and it's like...
he's actually reversing because he does look over his shoulder a couple of times all moodily. The montage is weird because I'm really not fond of montages where they show us what we've literally just seen. I had a problem with that in Suicide Squad. If you're unpacking a mystery, then sometimes show us the detail we missed. But we're literally getting a music video of Rocky watching his friend die, and we saw that 15 minutes ago. In fact, this montage starts at about 41 minutes, so we saw it about 7 minutes ago. But on the plus side, Chris, you get to work out to this.
I do. It's one of my go-to workout tunes, so yeah, that and Hearts of Fire.
Sorry?
So you must be pretty buff.
Me? Nah. Nah, I'm not. I'm working on it though, but no, I'm not buff. But I absolutely love this tune. It's what it's on constant rotation on my Spotify playlist. So yeah, it's just a moody, cool montage. I think
that's what this film is. It's a series of moods intercut with your scene.
Yeah, I mean, I do mean what I say. I do think there is like a little bit of logic in the, how it cuts the all previous scenes together in terms of like trying to think like about what Rocky's focus of thinking is at the time.
And he sort of changes gear as his mindset changes to something else.
Well, maybe, possibly. but it's like, you know...
He's thinking, hang on, people will hear that, and then they'll go back and look at it, and I might be talking bollocks, I'm not sure.
Yeah, no, I just looking at pure, but you probably are right. The point is that he's changing gears. He's like thinking of like his mindset under Drago, and he's thinking of Creed, and he's thinking, so he's thinking about
He's got incredible recall, though, because he remembers things he wasn't there for. Because he remembers Adrian celebrating his title win at home.
Yeah.
It's like, how does that work?
Well, I think it's just, like, shots of Adrian supporting him. It's that kind of, like, it's stuff that's a bit sort of to familiar yourself with that.
Yes, but he's reminiscing, isn't he?
I know,
he's reminiscing things he wasn't at.
Yes.
You imagine it. It should cut just to keep in theme. It should cut to like a scene from Planet of the Apes, and he weren't there for that. He weren't there for that either. But it was clearly an influence.
Oh shit! There goes the planet. So yeah, we have No Easy Way Out, and then you have like the scene where they're actually going to Russia. They're leaving the home. They're saying goodbye to Caesar.
Yeah. Now, that's all right at this stage, because at this stage, his mother's staying and just looking out the window like, you know, how we imagined Norman Bates' mum was until we realised she was dead.
Oh!
And then...
Oh, that's a comparison I never thought I'd hear.
It's a bit creepy, net curtain twitching. But anyway,
so they fly to... She's knowledge, really, isn't she?
They dress her really mousy as well in this. It's, she's getting irritated. She's always got a point. In isolation, she totally has a point. And I've just gone on for a while about how disrespectful he's just been to her. But she is like an irritation. She's just like, why have you bothered writing her in? I suppose you've got to have her there because you don't need to, I don't know. But they fly off to Survivor trying to reimagine their...
We're burning hearts.
Different singer. The singer died about a year ago.
Really?
The singer of this song. It isn't the same singer who sang Eye of the Tiger, and you can actually hear the difference when you know you're listening.
Yeah, a different vocalist.
That vocalist, it passed away about a year ago.
Oh, so sad.
I've never liked this song very much.
No, it's not Eye of the Tiger, is it?
It's not.
It's not a classic, I must say.
The music just thuds. It's just doom, doom, doom. It's not got any real invention in it.
No, but it's fine, you know.
It's like if Coldplay tried to go a bit more hardcore.
Probably.
It's like somebody said, "Hey, I need something that's like Eye of the Tiger, but more crap."
And goes, it does evoke it. It's kind of similar. Yeah. So they get to.
They get to like, you know, the
Wyoming. I mean Russia.
I was going to say that's not really Russia.
Well, yeah. I mean, what would they do? Would they write to like Russians and say, we'd like to film this in your country. Basically, it's us going on about how great we are, then we kick the ass of your best fighter. Oh, and all your people then applaud us.
They're like, yeah, come on, you can film with us.
Yeah, come on in.
Yeah, obviously at the height of the Cold War, they're like, no, let's not do that.
Just the difficulty level. So he's driven to the middle of nowhere. Paulie goes with him just to moan. Duke's training him, and you've got what you presume are KGB agents there, like looking out for them. or watching them, do whatever you want to say. Duke plays chess with one of them. But then you've got, literally, he finishes playing chess by beating them because, like, America and stuff. Obviously, we'd win at chess as well, the West. And then he goes up and talks to Rocky about, really cheesy scene about how when Apollo died, part of me died, which is just the most hackney fucking dialogue you could come up with.
It's like, yeah, I raised him. Like, so it's almost like a son to me. Which kind of things? I've always thought they were kind of like the same age.
I think I read something from the sort of expanded universe of this, in that I don't know that this is what was in Stallone's head. But there have been video games where, like, or books or something, where one of Creed's early fights was one of his last fights. They actually fought each other. But that doesn't quite jibe with I raised him. So I don't know, to be honest. I don't really care either, to be honest.
I mean, it could have just said,
he was
like,
close to Apollo. Apollo's now.
It could have just been like, we're like brothers. We were like brothers. We grew up together, kind of thing. You know, like, it would have been fine, wouldn't it? Would have worked the same way.
Whichever way you want to do it, it's just, I just can't believe he wrote that and kept a straight face where he put in, when he died, part of me died.
It's just like, that is no pain.
Terrible dialogue.
No pain. He just kept telling himself, no
pain.
I
love you, but I'm not in love with you is the only fucking thing as hackneyed that you could possibly put into a conversation in a film. So it's pretty piss poor, but then it's just non-stop montages, isn't it? They start training.
Yeah, you have the proper 80s synth montage music.
Yeah, which I can still hear that in my head from earlier. And the message again is Rocky's doing it all naturally.
Yes. Well, there is like a clear difference between the two. You have the first one, which is Rocky going on it on his own. So you have like the cuts between Drago, which is all machines, or like.
Not only that, he has got a ludicrous number of people around him.
Yeah. So it's all like sort of using machines, experiments kind of thing. And you've got Rocky, who's literally just doing like the usual man in the forest, man, you know, man of nature type sort of stuff, but he's doing it alone. He's at each of those scenes, he's kind of like doing everything on his own. He's like, whether it be running or cutting logs, and yeah, it's a good montage. I do like this montage. I prefer the next
montage.
Enjoy
the montage of the lot.
Did you enjoy watching him cut a log, Becca?
Yes, I did.
Disgusting. And then we literally cut between the two montages because, oh, we see that
it's like a Drago montage sandwich.
He is steroided up. We do see him get what we assume must be
steroids. I do think that's quite interesting. There's a comment made towards the start of the film about doping in Russian sport, and it's still relevant today.
Still relevant today. Well, I don't think it was as sophisticated in the 80s because basically a lot of the women athletes of that era took on very masculine traits. Sure. In their appearance, and it was sheer.
Brittany Nielsen definitely looks like she's from that kind of mold.
Yeah, though no one in this film's Russian. So, yeah, in between the two montages, Adrian turns up. And the first thing I thought was, it's not that easy to get a visa for Russia. Certainly not for a surprise visit, because you have to be invited there. So I was a bit confused.
She has no problem.
Yeah, she just turns up.
Hiya, how you doing?
Nice surprise. Missed you. So I've given you a thought personally. I've been training.
You know what? It was really weird because when I remember the scene, I always remember there being no dialogue. I always remember there being like.
They just saw each other.
Yeah, he just turns up and then it goes straight into Hearts on Fire. So it was almost like they just did the whole thing, Adrian thing, where Adrian like sort of gives him like the heart and the drive to carry on. But
it's and the like, next song, but, and the next montage is but, much more upbeat. Yeah.
Yeah. But and then that's it, which I think probably, even though that's not, could be handled better, probably works better than what we actually have in that kind of like this kind of dialogue where it's just like, missed you, I missed you too.
The problem is he's trained without incident, and yes, he's been training alone, but it was an entirely competent scene. You never got the impression he was missing anybody. Now, of course, he would miss Adrian, it's his wife, but she turns up and it's like, I missed you. And when he said, I missed you too, I thought, I can't imagine you've given her a thought, actually. Not during your days, I mean, because you've just been really, really busy. But the next training sequence, I both love and hate. It's very on the nose with the mirroring of what they're doing.
Don't you just love it when he's like crushes his Drago's picture in the mirror? He's now grown a beard.
And then he runs up a mountain and yells Drago. And I just think, oh, fuck off, really?
He's going to hear you from that mountain, is he?
I don't think he was actually. I don't think that was his benefit, for his benefit particularly. But yeah, it's all right. But it's just perfunctory. It's just that, the fight starts, or the arena stuff starts around, I think it's something like an hour and four. And they get to Russia at something like 48, 49. And it's just filling that 15 minutes. That's all this really is.
But the difference between this montage and the one that literally just happened was like, now we have Drago doing what he usually stuff, but we see, like, actually start seeing the injections he's getting, the steroid injections. But this time, now Adrian's here, he's now actually training with everyone else. So they're all, like, the trainer's there, Adrian, Paulie, they're all there kind of like, not actually doing the training, but they're like supporting him. They're like, he's there. Like,
should have Duke in the background just trying to sneak the odd go at chess as well. Because it's like, I was quite happy when you were out on your own. I was playing chess and winning and shit. Adrian's got there and they've got to go in the warm now.
Yeah.
And basically she just sits and watches approvingly as Rocky lifts heavy things.
Yes, but it's real stuff. It's like he's there, like pushing. He's like lifting up a cart when they're all on it, sort of cheering him on. It's that kind of like, yeah, when you got your like your friends behind you, you know, sort of to get you there, as opposed to like being in like a mechanical gym where you just sort of like
where you're just using scientific equipment,
yes,
you know, monitored by experts. Who would want that?
But to be fair, I'm fair on Drago. Even like the. Some of the parallels I don't really sort of see match up, particularly when you get to the end bit where he's on the treadmill and it goes the hill climb thing and he's going like a rate of knots. He's like really, really struggling, as you would do, because it's fucking difficult to go up that speed. And it's like cutting like Rocky and he's like going up a mountain, but he's not actually going at speed because that would be physically impossible. But the impression is saying like Rocky's like matching him. He's like outbeating him. But it's like, actually, you know, what Drago's doing is actually a lot more difficult, I would have thought. So, not like climbing a mountain's like piece of piss, but, you know.
Yeah, the other thing is, if Rocky stops for a bit of air, he's not going to tumble right back down the mountain, is he?
Well, yeah, exactly. You know, it's like he's going at his own pace. He's like, you know, but he's not like sort of pegging it like Drago is.
No, he's not. So, but anyway.
But we digress. We're
fully indoctrinated that what the Russians are doing is against nature.
Yes, he's kind of like being, should we say, not being all natural. There's a reason for why he's like this big, hulking,
yeah, it's not 100% natural,
superhuman that he is, yeah?
Yeah. He'd be like Banana Man before the banana without all these drugs. He'd be like Eric.
Uh-huh.
Good old Banana Man.
So we get to the arena where we've got, you know, a full press contingent. There's no money, but there's clearly still like TV rights and stuff. So there you go.
So yeah, there's some money in there somewhere.
Yeah, but basically, like, Rocky's not picking up a paycheck for it. I think that's basically what it means. Like,
they
would still probably sell tickets for that and stuff, so I'd have thought.
And this goes on forever. This takes quite a long time. It takes about 5 minutes or so to get them to the ring together.
Well, you know,
and then once they're there, we have to hear the anthems.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, Paulie, you know, says something that's quite sweet to him. He says, like, you know, you've always stuck by me.
Only to set up the one-liner in a minute.
Yeah, I know. But it's still kind of sweet, though. It's still kind of nice to sort of say, like,
if I could be anyone, I want to be you.
Yeah. You know, sort of says you've always stuck by me. You know, even though, like, everyone else would have said, ditch that bum. But you never did it. So it's kind of cool. But, yeah, it does pay off. so Rocky gets to the ring, doesn't he? And he's, like, met with, like, hostility, as you'd expect.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it almost, like, in a shock reversal... In comparison to what Creed did to him, he arrives with his big massive anthem and like and big massive like picture coming down the side of this massive stadium, so it's like almost like a sort of like ha touche.
And what's Gorbachev? Clearly Gorbachev there, but without the bird shit on his head.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought that was Gorbachev's with no Port Wine stain on his face.
Well, he has played that guy has played Gorbachev in like The Naked Gun and things like that.
Where do I know him before?
I was going to say, like, I was going to make a reference to that, so maybe obviously he's just like got wiped off by Frank Dragon.
Yeah, there you go.
No, yeah, it was the same man playing Gorbachev.
And then we get to the fight, which is like I said about wealth porn earlier. If it wasn't so associated with R-rated horror films, you could almost call this torture porn because it's just so over the top. It's him just taking this ridiculous fucking pounding for two rounds, and it's because the films have had to build on the previous ones each time. So it just gets more cartoonish each time. And Rocky will get knocked down and he'll get right back up and carry on fighting. No mandatory cake, no wiping the gloves off, no nothing. It's just bizarre, this film.
I do think it sets up just the size of Dolph in comparison to Stallone. That you do look at it and think, like, how is Stallone even going to get a punch in? Because he's just so tall and so, like, and so big. It's going to be, even just trying to get in close enough to land a punch is going to be hard. So there is that element I always found by watching it, is it's trying to find that and put, obviously, yeah, Rocky gets his ass handed to him, but as you'd expect in the first few rounds. But then doesn't the second round end with Rocky landing, like, yeah, landing
I think
the punch?
It is. That's just to say he's... And then it does go into, like...
A fully even match. Sort of, really?
A bit of a montage. It's a lot more even than you would think, but Rocky still gets put on his ass quite a lot.
Yeah.
I suspect, you know, I mean, he would get a points decision in Russia anyway, but you suspect on points he'd be significantly behind. Certainly on a 10-point must system, because he's getting knocked down so often. But it's okay. I've always found it a little bit over-stylized with the slow-motion fucking punches to the draw and all the rest of it. Drago doesn't do an awful lot of body punching at all. That may be his height. But it's just constant haymakers to Rocky's head. And you think, this would fucking kill anybody. Surely. You know, he's not, not dodging any fucking thing as usual. Although the films are more box office now, so he doesn't cut up like he used to. He just gets a slight swelling under one eye and, like, a little cut down the outside of the other. But, yeah, I could take or leave this. I think it goes on way too fucking long.
Basically have another montage between this until like the final round, don't you? You know, I mean,
there is something like this or 14, yeah, something like.
I mean, there is a bit of a dialogue kind of maybe laugh where Rocky kind of like sort of it's after he got he cuts him, like he gives him a punch at like these trainers basically sort of like after telling him look, you know, he's bleed, he's human, you know. He knew he was human.
No one was ever suggesting he couldn't cut.
No.
I've never got that at all. Even as a kid, it was like, so what?
Yes, but it's the image of it all. It's the fact that he's meant to be this like, big superhuman type figure.
Machine, basically. And he's trying to kind of humanise him, isn't he?
Yeah, and then you cut to Drago, and he's just like, he's not human. He's like a piece of iron.
Yeah. That bit where he says to him, I think it's at the end of the first round, where he says to him, I see three of them, and they say, hit the one in the middle.
Yeah.
I mentioned Max Baer a couple of weeks ago. That was said to him when he fought Max Schmeling. Max Schmeling was the first guy to beat Joe Lewis. Jack,
it's meant to be part of like boxing lore, isn't it? Apparently?
Yeah, Jack Dempsey was in his corner, who was an ex-champ. And Max Baer said to him, I could see three of them. He said, hit the one in the middle. It does come from real boxing lore. Once again, it tells me he must know his boxing. Because you don't just pull, particularly pre-internet, you just don't just pull that fact out of the air.
That's quite important.
It's not. I don't know that it's important. It's just that, you know, it's just that little sort of flavouring he throws into his script that you think, like, you must have learnt that from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So I just take it he's a genuine fan and that's a story he picked up along the way. Maybe it's a bit chicken and egg. Maybe it's because his best known character's Rocky that he actually started really following boxing closely. I don't know which way round it would be. But I just know I don't really give two shits about this fight for the most part. It goes on far, far too long.
I must say, yeah, of all the genuine thoughts I have with this film, I did feel this last fight did drag a little bit. All kind of tension just kind of wilted away really for me.
Well, because he's become indestructible at this point. He always gets up. And the thing is as well, they don't even make it difficult for him to get up. I mean, I know they were exhausted, but you look at the end of Rocky 2, where he's barely getting to his feet in time.
Sure.
And even the 14th at the end of the first fight, you know, well, at the end of the 14th round, you know, the referee takes a really good look at him after he gets up. Here, he keeps leaping straight back to his feet, which is not clever for a boxer anyway. You're supposed to take the count and things like that. And they're getting straight back to it. And he's being knocked, you know, he's being hit. Nothing ever gives you the impression he's going to get knocked out, because he gets to his feet instantly each time. So there's no tension in it. You just know that this guy is now indestructible. He's now a superhero. I mean, when the film started, I don't know if you noticed it, because I mentioned it a couple of weeks ago, Becca, how stiffly they walk to each other at the center.
Yeah, I noticed that. Yeah, I kind of picked up on that after what you said.
And then he started flexing his pecs.
Yeah, that was a bit strange. It's like a
superhero at this point. There's no tension in any of this.
No. Yeah, that was a bit odd. I was like, why are they so stiff? But there it is.
And then the audience start, like, you know, cheering for Rocky. And you think, well, all right, what are you trying to tell us here? Because we've had Paulie at one of the press conferences, who knows fuck all about anything, talking about keeping people behind barbed wire with machine guns. You think, well, if they're that terrifying a regime, would an audience full of people in front of the Politburo start cheering for Rocky?
Mm.
All you're telling us is it's not that bad, really, is it? They just supported their guy and they actually really respect Rocky now.
Yeah, but isn't that enough at the end of the day, though? Like, just respect for one another?
Yeah, it's fine, but it's just, yeah, I think, you know, the film is only an hour and a half long. We're into the final fight just after the hour point. Apollo is killed just after the 30-minute point. So, yeah, that's a three-act structure, but it's also fucking thin.
It is.
It really is, and I don't expect that much from it, really, but watching this again a couple of weeks after 2, which was probably the high point, despite the, in terms of fights, I mean, apart from the sort of contrived ending. There's just the lack of tension in this, and also the vanity in it, because they're oiled to shit in a way they weren't in the first fights. Only the most picturesque damage on his face compared to the first fight, where he looks like he's been hit by a truck. And I keep being told, I remember reading that they punched each other for real and they used real punch sounds. Well, they might have used a few real punch sounds, but most of this doesn't sound real at all. I've watched enough fights to know that's not what punches sound like,
yeah. For
the most part. And the other thing is, they're hitting each other for real, so this should all look really good. I mean, Sylvester Stallone ended up in intensive care for 8 days. Because 8 days, he was hit in the chest at one point and his heart swelled.
Christ.
And he was put in intensive care for 8 days. When the Creed fight was happening with Drago, Carl Weathers walked off the set for 4 days because Dolph Lundgren was just being too rough. He threw him into a corner at one point.
Too aggressive.
Yeah. So they took all this really seriously for quite a stylized and not that impressive end result. We're a long way from the fights, the first couple of fights here.
I mean, one thing I did pick up on, and I know it sort of there was something I know about the audience changing their perspective of Rocky, but I also think Rocky had an effect on Drago, because Drago starts actually sort of, I mean, he lashes out at his trainer.
I'll fight for me.
Yeah, and this is kind of like a sense of, well,
I'm not your puppet.
Yeah, and I thought that I kind of like that. I kind of like, even though he's taken on board from what Rocky's example was, which is like, yeah, actually, no, fuck this. I'm going to do this for myself. I'm not like, you know, I'm not going to be used like this anymore. I'm just going to break free. I'm going to sort of like do this man to man. And by the time they get to the last round, this happens at the final bell. Didn't he say something to him, like sort of like almost like, let's do this or something like that?
I don't know.
There's a kind of like, I think he says like to the end or something like that.
I don't know. So he's only got about 6 lines in this book. So now Rocky ends the Cold War.
He does.
He's taken them to the brink because they're already, you know, seeing that you can respect both sides.
The hearts are on fire.
Yeah. I mean, like, yeah, you know, surprise, surprise. He knocks Drago out eventually. He just, like, sort of just by punching him in the head loads of times. And that's it. And Drago spectacularly sort of tries to get up and then falls and actually falls through the ropes.
Literally.
Yeah. And it's like, it's funny, but it comes across as like, Rocky celebrates, it comes across as the most easiest victory in the world. It's like, he jumps up and goes, yes!
And it's all contrived by now. It's slightly different music than we've had in the previous films. And I do remember watching this with somebody years ago when I was at university. It was a friend of a friend was round. And I think we just watched the previous couple or something like that. And at this point, he was like, oh, yeah, again. And it's just lost impact with repetition. That's all. It was genuinely dramatic in the first couple of films when the fights ended and they were damaged and, you know, they'd been the fight hadn't gone how you expected. By now, it's very rote.
I don't know. I do have memories of being like on the edge of my seat watching this.
Well,
but that's when I was younger.
Well, just very quickly before we sort of go into final thoughts, I was really surprised in the cinema because the trailer for this film had Rocky wearing white gloves in the ring with Drago.
Right.
So I thought there was going to be another fight.
Well, you would,
I honestly thought, yeah. And now, by any structure of the way a film should be, that would make no sense whatsoever. But it took all tension out of it because he went, oh, he's won. Oh, and that's the end. All right, then. I like that, you know, because I was nine.
Yeah.
Really weird, but yeah. So he ends the Cold War. Yay.
What he wins the Cold War.
He wins the Cold War. He is now Cold War champion or something.
I don't know, I kind of want all speeches to be sort of interpreted in Russian from this.
Well, there was something I did read in the facts around this film that it got misinterpreted in the film. Because he said there were two people killing each other, which is better than 20 million. And it was translated into Russian on the film as, that's better than $20 million.
I did actually think that, because the things that Rocky was saying seems to be relatively longer than what was translated. So I wonder if, like, unless Russian's got a really, really short
efficient
hand.
Yes. Yeah.
I was like, hang on, that can't be right. That can't be the correct...
I just know that, like, the fight's outstayed its welcome, and hence I'm ready for the film to finish. I really am, even for the fun I've had with this. And that's my final thought, really, with this. It's 91 minutes. I wouldn't say it feels longer than that. I mean, the film whips by okay, but because, you know, it's so thin, we get the establishment of the new threat, Apollo coming back, Apollo dies, and then it's press conference, argument, montage, training montage, hello Adrian, training montage, fight. And that's the whole film.
I'm pretty sure
that was the script, but
yeah. Make up your own dialogue and places, everyone.
And good. That's pretty much the entire film in a nutshell.
Did you like it? Alright, fair enough, Chris.
Yeah, I think it's as you said, the script isn't really there. It's very loose, it's very fast, and it doesn't have any depth to really go on, but it is a lot of fun. It is enjoyable to watch, and it is kind of like goofy in its own little way, and you know, it has a lot of nostalgia to it. So I mean, there is joy to be had from this film. I won't begrudge anyone if they said it was their favorite, just because it was it just on the level that of fun that it actually
it's
is.
It's such an easy watch.
It is. And, I mean, I've always stood by the argument, the fact that because of that montage of No Easy Way Out, that you get to relive the best bits of Rocky 1, 2, and 3, and watch this. So this is probably, like, out of all the Rockies, this is what the most essential, because you can just watch. So that if you ever watch one Rocky film, folks...
I can make a lame argument the other way for next week, but it is lame.
Yes.
Yeah, if you do watch one, if you haven't got a lot of time to watch it, then this is the one to watch.
Yes.
No, it isn't. But anyway...
Rocky 5, maybe have that title.
Oh, dear. Can we take the taste out of our mouths of last week's blowjob and this week's thin plot with a quiz or some facts or something? Because the film's not that good. Becca?
Well, I've got some quiz questions about this week's film, Rocky IV.
Have you? What were the answers last week?
Oh, yeah, I might as well do that.
Yeah.
Hold on, wait while I find them.
Dead, folks.
I don't have my notebook. Hold on. Here's some music. Yes, thank you. I've got the questions from last week.
All right, then.
Okay, yep. So who does Rocky fight in the charity match, and what charity is it for?
Now, it's Thunderlips, but wasn't it some children's home or something? or orphanage.
Yep. Hulk Hogan, aka Thunderlips, is for the youth centre there.
Okay.
And how many rounds does that charity match last?
Wasn't it just two. The one?
Just two, that's right.
Was it two, the charity match?
Yeah.
Yep.
I don't remember them having a break in between. All right, fair enough.
Well, I think the break was when, like, Hulk Hogan threw him out the ring.
Oh, yeah. Just rest out there for a minute.
Yeah, just have a quick snooze.
All right, then. Yeah, go on.
Name a product Rocky endorses at the start of the film. It can be any of the sort of three or four main products that you see in the
film. Maserati, American Express. I can't think of any others, but there are
Crunch Punch.
Crunch Punch, all right. Oh, yeah, I remember that, the Rocky bar, yeah, yeah.
What naughty thing does Paulie do to get him arrested and thrown in jail?
He breaks the Rocky pinball machine. He throws a bottle at it.
Yeah. And then, obviously, where is the final fight held? Which location?
The final fight is Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, that was answers to last week's dead easy quiz.
That was a little bit harder than the ones that came before it, so this week's going to be...
Incrementally more difficult. So I've got five questions for Rocky IV.
Alright then.
Again, stupidly easy.
Well, it's not. You haven't got much to go on given the film, really, have you?
No, we haven't. I've literally tried to do these on the fly today, so. My fly wasn't very big, so I fell off him.
Must have been buzzing.
That sounds all kind of wrong. Show how tired I am. Note to yourself, don't do podcast when you've been up since small hours. Right, five questions for Rocky IV. Number one. How hard can Drago punch? Be it in PSI or pounds?
Which is the same thing,
pounds. I know. Pounds to square inch, exactly.
All right.
Well, I know, but they've got the little measurements, units of measurement, haven't they, by the side.
So. All right.
So how hard can Drago punch?
All right.
How many times can I mispronounce his name? Bloody hell, it's only four letters. No, it's five. Crap.
It's five,
oh, five letters. Yeah.
Otherwise, he'd be drag.
I'm gonna read these and then...
Or Ragu.
Or Ragu. Okay, anyway, question number two. How long has Creed been at retirement for before he makes his comeback to the ring? Question number two. Which location does the Creed Drago fight happen? Where is it? I want the name of the city and the name of the location. Question number four. What advice does Paulie have for Rocky? We discussed it a few moments ago. And then question number five. Rocky IV is the shortest film in the series, true or false? And that's the five questions that, again, ridiculously easy.
Okay. Got to know most of those.
They're stupid.
Next week's harder because there's...
Because I don't know.
Next week we'll sum it up more because there's...
Next week will be Mastermind.
Well, you've got a treat in store. This is the bit of the series I was looking forward to least because I've just covered Rocky IV, which is quite clear I'm not that keen of. Rocky V's just not fun.
No, let's have a look. What does it say?
It says it's not fun.
Rocky trains an up-and-coming young fighter but finds himself betrayed. ...
He does. I can tell you all about Tommy Morrison next week because he's dead now.
Oh. It's depressing. It's just passing away.
Yeah, that's all right. I'm sure I'll tell some inappropriate jokes about it.
Fun fact.
To make everyone feel better. So, having just
completed... Everyone has AIDS. 888888888.
Right, now, I've just told you what film is next week, listeners, but try to forget that while we do social media, because I've completely ruined the last line of the podcast. So anyway, you can find me at ThePastyKid1976 on Twitter.
You can find me at Cinematronics, and you can also find this podcast as well as the other podcast I do at cinematronics.co.uk.
And you can find us on Twitter at expectustotalk, on facebook.com/expectustotalk, youtube.com, just type in expectustotalk on the little search box there. We also on Letterboxd, letterboxd.com/inspect us to talk.
Inspect us.
Inspect us talk.
That's it. Penny, get me my gadget. And you can drop us an email.
Sorry, what was that? Just Penny.
Get my gadget.
I thought she said get on my gadget, which is even worse.
I'll just open this raincoat. My script for that film would be fucking awesome.
I've never seen that. I loved the cartoon series growing up, but I never saw the film, the live action movie.
That's alright, I'll write one for you.
Yeah, I did. I think I just did myself. But if you feel like dropping us an email, and you're not a Nigerian prince with all your billions and billions of pounds that we don't want, You can send us an email at theexpectustalk@gmail.com.
Okay.
If you're a Nigerian prince.
If you are a Nigerian prince, send us a pigeon, as previously discussed.
Carrier pigeon will do.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm hoping you forgot 3 or 4 minutes ago, listeners. What's next week, Becca?
Do you expect to talk? We'll return with Rocky V.
Yay.